Blessed Redeemer, Lee Nash's cover version of it from her album Hymns and Sacred Songs. I just revisited that album today and I was really enjoying it, and I just picked a couple songs off of it that stood out for me, and made charts and decided to do videos and stuff, since I kind of need to get back on the trail here with some videos. At least try to get you one or two a month. Nothing else, try to keep you entertained. Yeah, to really keep the channel going. I'll go into playing what I feel I need to play, and then, because this song's another really repetitive song that probably teaching you the first verse and chorus is probably enough, because the second verse and chorus and the third verse and chorus are pretty much, there's very, very, very little variation. It's pretty repetitive. The magic of the recording is really the way the band plays through the dynamics. Like, they get soft on verse 3. The way that they kind of come in and out with the instruments, and the way that the instruments are played and woven together in the different little parts is really what makes the song the more... What at the foundation is a very simple song, a very complex and beautiful rendering of it. So anyway, this is going to be sort of this is going to be me giving you, quote-unquote, the backing rhythm guitar part, which could translate into an easy campfire version of this song. I'm going to try to do another video with me capoing on the fifth fret, where I kind of have a rhythm that has the lead part inside of it playing, so it's a little bit more complex, and captures a little more of the complexity of the recording. Like I said, so if you haven't heard it, it's beautiful. I'd really recommend it. I personally enjoy it. So, anyway, here we go. Here's the intro. That was basically full speed, and I feel my strumming pattern's pretty darn close to what happened on the recording there, so you're getting a better, more accurate a rendering of it this time. But it's basically a C major and D major, switching back and forth. If you want to use fancier chord names, you could say C add ninth and D suspended, I think, would be my recommended chords that I believe are more accurate to the actual what I'm actually playing. So it's sort of like my Love Song for Savior video, where I'm kind of leaving my fingers here most of the time, and all the changes are happening with my middle finger and pointer. So in this case, I'm doing if I want to have five strings ring, if I don't feel the need for that D string, I'll just press the fifth string and mute the one below it, which is the D string I'm talking about, so I can go, and that string is, and you'll notice when I strum, you probably don't even notice it. I'm even touching the low string a little bit as I press down. It's like this finger curls over the fourth string and it touches the sixth, so it mutes those two strings, so I only hear what I want to, or what I'm supposed to. So, muted. And I can probably should even just practice not hitting the low string at all, to just leave it out, since it's not supposed to sound anyway. And when I switch to my D suspended, my finger just comes up enough, and then it rests between the fifth and sixth strings. So it's, and there's that. And again, when you're going fast, nobody notices the. At least they shouldn't. Or you can even get to the point where you know you only hit the fourth string down when you play it. But I'm just muting those for insurance to make sure they're not making noise when they're not supposed to. Because I mean, I'm kind of doing it like this, so there's kind of might look sloppy, the strumming. I'm trying to clean up my strumming and my muting and all these things that, I had issue or didn't pay attention to before, so I'm playing a little bit cleaner. So there's that for the intro. There's that riff that's... Or just go... Guy's supposed to play that part. It has like chorus and reverb on it. You know, let him do his magic with his multi-effects pedal there. While you strum, maybe you need a chorus effect on your acoustic if you have that option to thicken up the soup of the sound of the song, which is what they do on the recording, it sounds like, anyway. So yeah, there's the intro. And then we're going into the verse. So, verse and chorus leading into the second verse. Like I said, this song's like 90, it's like, it doesn't change hardly at all. So I think giving you all that is probably enough. There's just a lot of muting going on in the chords. In the G, I have a, and you could go, or you can, I can press down the sixth and mute the fifth while I press down, because it just naturally curls over and touches it, so, or whatever works. Actually, kind of having that note in there kind of complements the bump a little bit, having the B note in your G chord, because the first note that the singer sings is a B note, so. I'm gonna kind of let you figure out how you like to strum it. If you have some freedom there. So there's that. Let me show you what it looks like. This video was supposed to be shorter than the last one. There's my intro. 6 counts each on those chords. Verse 1, the G and C in Blessed are 3 counts each. I mean, yeah, I would listen to the recording and feel out the changes as much as my video. My video is not going to teach you how to play the song note for note, beat for beat. Not gonna. That's too painful for me to make, and that's too painful for people to watch. So I'm not doing that. There's your first chorus. Feel free to pause the video and really look at the words. So with the chords. There, that last D chord getting 6 counts before you jump into the next verse. The second verse and chorus here. There you go. Basically, you're not doing anything different. You might notice I put an A major in the second line and an A minor in the fourth. Really, it's just some kind of A chord. Whether you played it major or minor, I think people wouldn't notice. Most average folks would not notice the difference. Maybe if I was to recommend one over the other, I'd probably say play the minor. I I tried to get that right. There's some nuances. She has a good band behind her, so, you know, they're good. I did my best to translate what they did. The second chorus, technically those CDs over there, there's four sets of them. So if you want to just think times four, that works too. I understand if that's a little, like, oh, why do you do that? It's confusing. Verse three, there's verse three there. Really the same chord progression. The only thing that's different in terms of recording is it gets quieter. Not as many chords are played, maybe for the first two lines, and then the band kind of comes in back on the third line. And I just left the chords that aren't, you know, in what seem to be not in the recording, not there. You know, if you want to fill in the blanks, just look at your previous, instead of just the G, it would be G, C, and G, I think, or there'd be a C between there or something. You know, if you can't feel it out, I apologize. So there's that. And then finally, page three, the third and final chorus, is there to look at as well. Here that CD happens a total of three times, and then it ends on G. If that's confusing, if that helps clear up any confusion there. But yeah, that's Blessed Redeemer, Lee Nash's cover version from her album Hymns and Sacred Songs. I was listening to these songs today, and they were just speaking to me, and so I decided to go ahead and tutorialize them for other folks who maybe they're getting spoken to by them too, but they need a little help figuring them out. So there you go. Or if you just need some new songs to throw into your praise and worship routine, and, those are some nice versions. They're still, I think that record only came out about maybe 5-10 years ago, so it should be still fairly current. You can get away with playing it at your church. So, anyway, keep learning, enjoy, and God bless you.